Chief Executive.
Please be seated.
Welcome everybody, this full council for September the 8th. Welcome everybody, and I'll hand over to Jim for any housekeeping. All staff, if you please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think I've alerted most of the members of the board tonight that there are fire alarms, past the sex of years, that's exited calling, first advice contact centre. If that's the end where there's a danger, officers will guide people out of the building through the two doors outside of me. If anyone has a mobile phone, they can see me, so please listen to silence so there's no disturbance during the meeting. And you can also remind me to use the microphone to talk down and speak, please.
Just to remind members, please to ensure that everybody conducts themselves in the manner which everybody wants to be treated with respectfully before we start the meeting. Can we then please receive apologies for absence, please?
I've had no notification of any apologies for absence this evening.
Thank you. Receive any declarations of interest by members?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to declare a community interest in item 13.
Thank you. Councillor Alan Black.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Personal interest in item 13, appendix A. My name is actually missing from that, but it should be on there.
Thank you. Councillor Stephen Thomas.
Same as Councillor Clark, but mine should be out for help of task with an employee, and also I am employed out of the airport manager.
Thank you. Councillor Stephen Blanchett.
I would like to declare the same interest as Councillor April Blanchett.
Thank you. Councillor Alan Barclay.
I'd like to declare the same interest for Oak Hill and Steve Oak.
Thank you. Councillor Jim Lindridge. Do you have any questions, Councillor Lindridge?
Yes, it's the same as Councillor Barclay. So
thank you. Councillor Sandra Belcher.
This is the same request.
Thank you. Just wait a second, please. Anybody else? Yes? Come on, sir.
I'm interested in Jed Jackson 13. My husband works for Helport Chapel.
Thank you, Councillor Tempest. Councillor Kevin Cranny.
Yes, Chair, I'm just declaring this an item 13 for Bellevue Sports Centre.
Councillor Paul Thompson.
Same item, but I think mine is in the same place that Councillor Clark has been admitted from the list.
Thank you. Can I also declare my interest as being a member of Westview Project, please? Are there any others, please? No? Thank you, Mr. Lesk. Councillor Hall.
Most of interest, Director of City Futures, not you.
Okay, thank you. Right, item 3. Deal with any business required by statute? There's none. To approve the minutes of the last meeting held on the 7th of July, can I turn those as a true record, please? Thank you. Lots of questions from members of council on the minutes of the last meeting on the 7th of July, Councillor Paul Thompson.
Chair, I've got two items. One of them is under minute 26. Councillor James was asked by a member of the public what the impacts of the flowers that have been around Parliament. But the Councillor James gave a very interesting, I suppose, remedy of hay fever about taking over the source fully. As I mentioned on the night, I'm a hay fever sufferer myself, so I was very intrigued at this mystery medicine and thought I'd go away and research it. Sadly though, I just wanted to set the record straight that in early 2000s, University of Connecticut Health Centre.
Good day, Councillor Thompson. I've got a question as regards the minutes.
Well, I'm correcting the minutes, there's a factual inaccuracy. Oh, yeah. And I'm correcting the information that Councillor James presented on the right.
Okay, thank you.
Moving on. There was some research done by the University of Connecticut in the early 2000s where a number of people that were randomly selected all suffering from hair fever all assigned into three groups. S group received locally collected, unpasteurised, unfiltered honey, the type that Councillor James referred to on the right. The second group were given nationally collected, filtered, pasteurised honey, and the third were basically given corn syrup with artificial honey flavouring. All hay fever sufferers are instructed to consume a daily dose of 1 teaspoon of the honey or substitute and stick to the usual methods they use to manage the season allergies. All participants were asked to track using 10 subjective allergy symptoms in the diary. However, Councillor James, the results were slightly disappointing because none of the people experienced any relief from the symptoms, regardless of whether taking local or non-nationally collected honey.
Thank you.
Yeah, the second point is that the minute 27 part D, chief executive, through yourself, the chief solicitor, offered me the opportunity to go and listen to the explanation of events that happened through the fire authority. I have since then been approached by a member of the public who said, and corrected me, that information was promised to come back into the public arena. And I would request that that happens so in line with the restrictions and the response that was given on several occasions earlier on this year.
Mr. Devlin, do you wish to respond?
Yes, Mayor, certainly. I definitely meet with Councillor Thompson, as mentioned, in private. This month, actually, if ever got basically for a public forum, i.e. a meeting of the Fire Authority, would then be open to general discussion. Not done so therefore it's one of the minutes in private application matter.
Thank you very much, your base.
Right.
Any other items from the minutes?
No.
Thank you. Answer questions from members of the council on the minutes of the to deal with any business required by statute under item 6 and on. Item 7, receive any announcements from the head of the service. I just have one. And that is to mention that there will be a mayor's dinner on October the 22nd, which is a Saturday night, which will be held in the World Mill Lion. If anybody wishes to attend, please contact the girls in the office and they will sort out the ticket. Item 8, to dispose of any business remaining for the last meeting, there is none. Item 9, personal reports from the council committees, audit and governance committee update by Councillor Ray Martin Wells.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. On the 25th of June 2015, delivery of the council's health scrutiny responsibilities was delegated to audit and governance committee with our work programmes were reported to you annually. I can now report that in 2016 our planned investigations will be focusing on two specific areas outlined in section 3 of my report. Our investigation into access to transport for people with disability is in fact now nearing completion and our second investigation in relation to mortality rates is about to commence. Equally important is the reactive work we undertake in relation to substantial variation in health service and council callings. In relation to crime and disorder issues as well, a significantly important example of our work is in relation to provision of assisted reproduction service from the University Hospital of Hartlepool. Whilst our successes have been extensively publicised, it is appropriate at this point to formally update you. Section 2 of my report recaps the process undertaken upon your instrumental decision to support legal action against the Trust. The resulting consent order ensued and the continuation of service pending the outcome of the full consultation, which in turn led to a decision by the CCG's governing body that, and I quote, a comprehensive assisted reproduction service, including HFEA licensed and unlicensed provision, would continue to be provided from the University Hospital of Hartlepool. The service is to be delivered from the University Hospital of Hartlepool site by an alternative provider. As a committee, we commend the CCG's governing body on its decision and welcome assurances that a existing provision would be maintained with patients unlikely to see any changes. Patients would receive all treatment in Hartlepool and there would be no patients potentially impacted. The pre-procurement process is now underway and the intention to tender has been advertised with the invitation to tender to be advertised in October. As Chair, I'm keeping a watching brief on the process and the continued provision of the service until a new provider is identified. We will be requesting a formal update following completion of the contracting process. Whilst we acknowledge the cooperation of the Trust in allowing an alternative provider to continue provision of the ARU service from the hospital site, we have not forgotten the contempt the Trust has shown in the scrutiny process, this Council and members of Hartlepool Public. The Trust therefore will be held to account at a future meeting. And I would ask members to note the report, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much indeed, Councillor Mark Wells. Any comments? Thank you very much indeed, Councillor. Item 10. To consider any of the business specified in the summons of the meeting, to receive questions and answers on any of those items, which is a periodic review of the Council Constitution. Mr. Devlin.
Mayor, thank you. Members of the public, I go through my report in some elemental detail, because I appreciate this. Time that we have available this evening. Actually, stopping before the recommendations on questions. So, therefore, I shall deal with two parts of the general comment of the report, stop for any questions from members, and then actually proceed on with the recommendations at section 3 of the report. Go on to each recommendation, isolation from each other. Members will be aware, 17th of March of this year, a variety of motions came before Council, some of which actually resonated within the terms of this report. Just for a quick recap for everybody, Article 15 of the Constitution provides for myself as Monitoring Officer to monitor and review the operation of the Constitution and ensure that the aims and principles of the Constitution are given full effect. And from that, I do actually take soundings from individuals, call and analyse issues that are raised. And by virtue of those motions that were raised previously, our Council did decide they would have a member seminar. That member seminar would be open to members of the public. And those seminars were held on the 27th and 30th of June of this year. In total, there were 11 elected members attending those seminars and 5 members of the public. I'm grateful for their we proceeded upon an issues paper, and that is actually appendix report, appendix 1, and follows the format which we adopted when we changed our governance arrangements back in 2012. Members are reminded that the Constitution has to contain our standing orders, now termed as the procedure rule. A copy of the Council's Code of Conduct, such information, the Secretary of State shall determine, otherwise there's great latitude to the authority about what information within the confines of this Constitution. I should point out to members this evening that any changes they made to their Constitution on their procedure rules, under Procedure Rule 24.2, any motion to add, vary, or revoke procedure rules may be standing adjourned to the next meeting, ordinary meeting of Council. So they don't take any effect this evening, but also be deferred to the following ordinary meeting. As regards items for consideration, going through each one in turn. Duration of meetings, as you will be aware, your meetings presently have a duration of some 2.5 hours, start at 7 p.m. go to 9:30, unless actually the majority of members decide to continue on with the meeting beyond 9:30. Previous guidance given by the old Department of Transport and the Regions did indicate that levels of concentration that cannot be maintained over extensive periods of time. And therefore, senior members should ideally have shorter duration meetings rather than longer meetings. And therefore, I do recommend, and this came out really from the seminar, that essentially you constrain the meetings to for a duration of 2 hours, 7 p.m. to 9 p.m, but with the caveat that if the majority members agree otherwise, they can proceed beyond those time restrictions. Public questions, presently we allow 45 minutes for public questions. Recommendation I made from the seminars is that we actually have those hearing for 30 minutes, which actually is in keeping certainly with other local authorities, certainly the Tees Valley, who operate public questions. I should point out that by and large, local authorities don't have the facility for public questions. But again, that should be at the discretion of the chairperson to extend that period if so required. As regards to the notes and order of questions, there's no actual recommendations to depart from what we have presently in our constitution. As regards to the number of questions, we used to have a situation of there's one public question with two supplementary questions, and then we moved to two questions but without supplementary questions. As I mentioned in my report, I appreciate the sensitivities behind the subject largely based upon supplementary questions. Within Tees Valley, one authority does not have supplementaries, three others do have, and I say it's not a uniform picture across local authorities. As I mentioned, there's no right or wrong answer on this particular matter, but I was actually observant to a representation made by a local business association who felt it was essential to have that mechanism and that engagement basically with local communities. And members, the golden thread going through my report this evening, I'm sure you've detected it, that you really need to give detailed consideration as regards how you basically connect with your community and as regards the overall evaluation of what they consider to be important and basically their public involvement and engagement in what you do as regards councillors. You have clearly got a potential role, but this actually goes wider than that. I've mentioned the report, it's mentioned again the report, the your Say Our Future, which was a very successful formative part of how the council actually looks towards engagement with the community. And again, issues of that nature really need to be explored. As regards the scope and record of questions, again, there was no representations to warrant any change in that regard. As regards asking questions at the meeting, I know some members felt that members of the public should actually have the ability to read out their questions as is formally the case, other than actually the chief executive reading out those questions before a meeting. Essentially, it's been said this evening, we have one of the questions this evening, that's going to pro forma, and having Jay, that it's really to make the question put forward, which is an important consideration, not really to the person actually who raises it. As regards questions by members, we presently have 1 hour, 30 minutes allocated to member questions. That is completely out of time, and with all other local authorities, we must have 30 minutes, and therefore, my recommendation is 30-minute duration for member questions. Again, the residual discretion of the chair to extend that period if he or she thinks it's desirable to do so. And I also indicate that for the sake of completeness, in response to a member question, which is under Council Procedure Rule 12.5, either by way of a direct oral answer or a potential written response, should be maintained. That position should be monitored and again should be reflected upon as regards that overall public engagement involvement. As regards notices on motion, Council previously indicated yet 7 clear days was required to ensure motions were basically placed upon the agenda and summons for your meeting, and that's a statutory requirement. But it was indicated that the present requirement for 5 members should be reduced to 2 members. And indicated that there's no statutory impediment as to the number of members that should actually warrant a notice. On motion, the important thing actually is the motion should be something of a significant nature, a matter really which actually needs to be debated before council, thoroughly discussed and dealt with in that manner. And whether it's signed by 5 members or 2 members is largely academic. But it is basically a matter which council can determine this evening, hopefully by some degree of consensus. As regards the potential limit on the number of council motions, we did actually have something of a record previously with the remote motions that came before the council. Have been told that a neighbouring council did receive a number of motions in one of their recent council meetings. No councillors in the Tees Valley area had any strict limits upon the number of motions, for a table question will be two or five. As regards the rules of debate surrounding discussion on motions, presently we have, it's the old modular constitution requirement, the proposer and mover of a motion has 10 minutes to speak, and everybody else actually has 4 minutes. Most local authorities actually have the 10 minutes and 4 minutes, which I say originates from the old modular constitution, which first came into effect in about 2002. Some actually have agreed me at the time. Generally, it was felt that maybe 5 minutes would be allowable to propose the motion, and has suggested maybe 3 minutes for everybody else. I am conscious that 4 minutes prescribed in your regulatory committees. The planning committee licensing generally have 4 minutes. And again, actually, it's not the exact science. It's for members largely to determine. And certainly, actually, getting moved on that this evening, it should be closely reviewed and monitored in this exercise. As regards to reference to council, this is a quirk constitution. In the House Procedure Rule 27, in that 17 or more members, so effectively just over half the composition of council, we have 33 members, so 17 plus 4, can, if need be, refer a matter to council or their policy decision taken but not yet implemented. So essentially, it's a call in mechanism. It's never had to be exercised since we changed our governance over 3 years ago. And we actually have a mechanism within that procedure rule which allows actually discussion to take place to obviate the need for a matter actually not to be called in to council. For invariably, if a matter actually is in such import, it normally ends up in the floor of council in any event. It was requested that the number of 17 or more be reduced to 5. And again, it's a matter really to largely the discretion of council to consider. As regards the review and revision of the constitution, it was suggested that at the first ordinary meeting of council in the new municipal year, particularly following the elections, that a review then takes place of the constitution by way of a periodic review. I'm happy to do that, but I have added a caveat, unless otherwise directed, in that timetable allowed by council. At neighbourhood forums, certainly the expressions that I received actually as part of this review, some members liked neighbourhood forums, others seem to loathe neighbourhood forums. And certainly it does actually generate a certain divided opinion. But again, actually, to me, it's a useful mechanism, that conduit based upon which you hear the views of the public. And again, this is something that should be explored, as in that wide picture. Have expressed should be taken further forward. So I can't really, I think we deal with tonight by way of my report. It's recently based that members need to grasp and take forward, and therefore that's a strong recommendation in my report. Miscellaneous matters, we have sound demonstrations took place on the 8th of August. I know members of the public and CHGO and Lady actually signified about these proceedings this evening, maybe difficulty actually in hearing and picking up the microphones. We've had a sound demonstration, we are moving forward with that, and those matters actually will always concentrate in mind on myself and particularly the chief executive officer. Other matters are timing of committee meetings. I have actually appended the information which we have received back on timing of meetings. I make no assessment of that information, and certainly previously members have indicated they were just looking at randomly impact assessments. Regarding timing meetings. It's here merely for information purposes, and again, something that you need to take forward that wider dialogue with the Oz community. So, Mr. Mayor, I will pause there before I actually go through the formal recommendations for any questions.
Any questions? Councillor Paul Johnson.
One question first, Councillor Paul Johnson. First question then, there is some clarity over if a proposal of a motion is being, can be further curtailed and restricted down to 5 minutes, will the same apply for people who are presenting reports? Because in effect, a report is asking for some action in the same way that a motion does, it's asking for some sort of agreement. So is that the same because with respect, if it is, the Chief Solicitor's own presentation of the Minutes report wouldn't have matched the 5 minutes. Likewise, Councillor Riggs Belcher's MTFS with a PowerPoint a couple of months ago wouldn't have done the same. So there's some clarity on that one, please.
Chair, the content of that speeches actually is under, sorry to be so pedantic, it's not as, it's under Procedural Rule 15.3, which actually relates to essentially the rules of debate. Moving and seconding motions. So it is actually confined to those motions. I'm sure members of the public wish it was 5 minutes per se, but for myself, but it is actually solely related to any of the motions.
Have you another question?
No question, I'll come back to it in a minute.
Okay, right. Any further questions for the. No? Right. You bid?
Yeah, I think it might be worthwhile going to item by item on most and get the members out of consensus or part from that.
If going to vote on each of these items, it would be a recorded vote. Yes, Councillor Thompson.
Chair, if we proceed to a vote, then I'd like to engage the debate.
No, no, we're not going to a vote. I said when we do actually get to it, we will be having a recorded vote.
Okay.
Chair, that's what I would say. Some matters you might well record by way of the vote. Other matters, actually, the general consensus, I think we bypass that by way of a general show of hands. We've been very optimistic, sorry. 3.1, Chair, the first recommendation, the council meeting commencing at 7 p.m, stands adjourned at 9 p.m, because the majority of members agree for the vote.
We feel that actually there shouldn't be a time limit at all. That we are elected representatives for the town, and if there are issues that need attention here and now, it doesn't matter what time it is. I'm happy to go on to 1 o'clock in the morning if it needs so. Thank you.
Chair, I will say, first of all, by going through these recommendations individually and allowing debate after each one, just saying a little bit bizarre and have a bit more of it, not sharing bits so, you know, I'll say enough more of it. There's a common thread with most of a lot of these points that we've made today, and it's about curtailing this council meeting, curtailing the voice of the elected representative and the people that we serve. That's the common thread. Whether it's stop limit at 9 o'clock, limit questions to sorry, public questions to 30 minutes, allowing us to only speak for 3 minutes or 5 minutes, or put motions for 10 minutes, it's all about telling the members of this council that we will be represented. And we are heading towards almost drive-by council meetings, where we all turn up in the car park, tuck our horns, and leave, and that's the business conducted. Because what's the point of doing the need? I spoke to an elected member who sat opposite, and I'm not going to embarrass them back, but I knew them. They said to me that they didn't feel that the council chamber was the proper place for debate. And we should just come in and we should just rubber stamp report. This council chamber is not the proper place for the debate. Where on earth is? It's appalling. And some of the recommendations in this report, people need to hang their heads in shame at this. I'm absolutely furious. And that's just my first point. We'll come up with the next one. But the next time.
It's been a proposal that the Labour Group accept the proposal as the first item that's been recommended by the monitoring officer. Anybody against?
Yes. Sorry, Chair, I fully respect the Labour Group's decision to go ahead and reach height as you would like to be shown in both the back and the floor too.
Without the people sat in that or in that public gallery, we wouldn't be here. Yeah. They elect us to represent the
Yeah.
Chair, I should say about 30 minutes is fixed to the discretion of the chair to extend the meeting.
Yeah. If you wish to speak once, by all means do so and make a point. Councillor Inman Wells.
Thank you, Chair. Personally, I've been in council meetings when we've been here till I think 10:45 one night, and I didn't have a problem with that. And that was when the guillotine was at 9:30. There's nothing that's in the Chief Solicitor's report that's saying that the meeting will end at that time. It's just saying that that's at the point which will give members the opportunity to vote whether to decide to continue or not. And that's why I supported the last one. Quite simply, if we were in the middle of a debate on something, I wouldn't vote to end that just so I can get home at 9 p.m. And as far as public questions go, then I would encourage the public to attend the committees where the actual recommendations and decisions take place, because we want a committee system now. Something that some of my colleagues to the side and behind me maybe haven't quite grasped, because they don't turn up to most of
them. Where? On the job.
And all I would say to that is, if you know you can't attend, then you shouldn't put your name forward. Because we're going to see later on that we have a request that we actually increase committee sizes so a certain political party can be a member. But as again, just look at the attendance to date, and I think we will see how that one's going to go. But I don't have a problem with meetings continuing, Chair. I would support meetings to be continued, but we need to try and pull ourselves in line with other local authorities within the Tees Valley, and that's why we're going to support it.
Councillor Riddle.
Yeah, just with regard to that comment there, I'm actually quite offended by that.
I didn't say no.
You didn't need to. As a working councillor, so you have a job and need to earn money to pay a mortgage and feed a child, and, you know, provide for my family, there are meetings in the daytime which I can't get to because I'm busy working. Like the vast majority of people in this town are busy working, trying to put food on the table. So to expect them to turn up to daytime committee meetings, the vast majority of people do not have the luxury to do that. I do not know how some people manage to pay their mortgage and to provide for their family on just the council's allowance of around £600 a month, but obviously some people do. So if you'd like to share with me, you know, how much you do that.
Generally, I share the same view. I think it's wrong of Councillor Martin Welsh to make such a statement, because actually, quite a few weeks back, I chaired the first working group on access to transport for people with a disability. And for a time, for at least half an hour of that meeting, I was the only councillor in the room.
Thank you. Any further comments? No? Thank you. Peter?
Yeah,
all those for, we show. Thank you. All those against. That's passed. Thank you.
This, said Chair, is the golden thread of my report, and I hope it's one that Council can fully endorse. The Council agrees to undertake an evaluation of its approach to public involvement and participation, and consider its approach to public questions, neighbourhood forums, and anything else I've mentioned this evening, and putting more wider issues as part of a future report that takes account of that kind of review. And again, I value the report to members to look at that matter.
Thank you. Councillor Thompson.
What I can support, that's something that I won't probably say again tonight. And the reason why I can support that is because if we're true to our words and we're going to engage with members of the public and then we're going to listen to the members of the public, I think it's probably worthwhile turning the page to the appendix 2. And only because it relates to the previous comment, we talk about timings of meetings and 45.51%. Or members of the public said they'd like committee meetings to take place on an evening. So we're going to engage with them. Let's start with that. Let's listen to that majority. the same majority, by the way, that some people in this chamber are elected with a less majority of them. The other thing to add to that, we turn the page over, and a cumulative 85% of people said they'd like meetings to start at 6 o'clock in the afternoon. So if we're really honest and we're really truthful and we're really saying that we're going to engage with members of the public through neighbourhood forums and through attendance to this meet, to these types of meetings and to committee meetings, let's start by listening to them on this report that we commissioned, a truthful report. There you go. Let's have meetings for an evening. Good to know, I feel popular. I didn't even wear for me before my hand up as a man. That's
anticipation.
Chair, I wasn't actually believing I intended to speak on this one until there was a reference brought up around the discretion of the chair. And not so much questioning your discretion, but the fact that Councillor Martin Wells referred to the night that we were sat here till 11:15. Because whilst discretion was exercised that night, I've also sat in this council chamber and discretion hasn't been exercised. And the meeting has been curtailed at that point when we've all been talking. And it turns out, well not turns out, but it just happens to be, whatever's convenient at the time will be the way that the discretion's exercised. Now I'm hoping, but obviously we have you as chair, and you'll do a very good job, I'm sure, but that discretion has to be fair and has to be balanced and has to be appropriate to all elected members in here.
Yeah.
Not when it's been decided at 6:00 the night before the committee will be. That we can't do that with notice. It seems preposterous. It's madness. It's something that's not quite right. And I would vote and move that we actually move it down to two people. Which is two people.
Thank you. Councillor Riddle.
Yeah, I want to support the proposal being to reduce it down to two, primarily because of, I guess, political balance, political representation. I mean, I respect the Labour group had a quite significant majority in council, but I'm also aware that the Conservatives, who are 3 members under the current system, wouldn't be able to put forward motions in council. So, given that our group only has 2 independent representations, what I'm hoping really is to support is we are to support the Conservatives.
Councillor Tennant?
Yeah, I should say in the interests of democracy and then the public vote. It's important that all groups are able to put forward their own motions in order to have a proper debate about all issues that go right across the town. I respect that, yes, the majority group is opposite to me, but also equally a Conservative group may also want to put forward motions for themselves. Thank you.
Right. Also, Mark Wells.
Thank you, Chair. I'm fairly confident if we wanted to put a motion forward, we would have managed to find another term. But yes, as there are 3 hard-working Conservatives in this chamber, I do take on board what has been said, and to Councillor Riddle's surprise, we would actually support 2. Thank you. Can I go back to please all those in favour of 5? All those against?
Chair, 3.6, recommended the council accept for additional motions approved by the Chief Executive Officer. The number of motions before an open meeting council should not exceed either 3 or 5. Discretion, submit the call to Council Sheen, who also need a bit more.
Thank you, Councillor Riddle.
This is just a question for me. If we do want to do that, how will the motion be handled in terms of priority? Like, if, for example, you've got several, or how would you decide which stream we're going to go before the council at that moment?
So we do it by balance. The Chief Member's informed this, and she's doing the determination to take the vote out of 3 or 5.
Yeah, I'm just so concerned really that if a political group so desired, which I don't imagine one would, but if the one to all most bottleneck things we need to do in the council, bottleneck motions of review report, it would be possible to just flood to the council with any more motions we would potentially take place. I think priority looks quite significant. So I do think it's a dangerous way to do that. And if it was a political group, you know, the point to sort of throw a spanner in the works occasionally, you go up in the door and do it.
Thank you, Chair. Certainly around election time, I've witnessed many, many motions come before this chamber. And I do think that there needs to be some kind of restriction. To be honest, we'll happily go with the floor, whether it's 5 or 3. But we've witnessed in this chamber where there's been just absolute grandstanding by. And it normally is just one political group, normally, and in fairness, it's not been from us, and there's not that many multiple motions come from opposite me. But we have had times where there's been 7, 8, 9 motions put before this chamber. So I do think that there needs to be some kind of restriction on it. But I do, I absolutely agree with Councillor Riddle in as much as there's got to be some fair way of actually agreeing where motions politically and make sure that they are balanced if they're coming from the political party.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Thompson.
Sorry, I'm just slightly taken back about a couple of things that Councillor Lambert said there, grandstanding at election time. Assistant reproduction on this brings to mind. Anyway, let's be honest about this. The whole reason that we're here tonight talking about the changes to the constitution is because a number of independent minded councillors submitted a large number of motions to a council meeting some time ago. And the reason we're here is because certain councillors don't like the rules of engagement, so what we want to do is change the rules. And change the rules to shut up people like me, people that sat in this council chamber before, and people who still sat. That's the reality. Yeah. The reality is that this council's constitution has been changed more in the 6 years that I've been an elected member than the entire constitution of the United States of America. So that's how true it is. Because what happens is when people don't like what's being said, are not erudite and articulate enough to be able to have that debate across the council chamber, they sit there, put their heads down, they shut up and change the rules.
Is Mayor, I'd like to move the limit to 3, subject to agreement by the Mayor in consultation and the Chief Executive.
I'll second that.
Please, there seems to be a question of clarification from Councillor Martin as well as Councillor Riddle. Just to correct Councillor Thompson, I didn't set the timescale for the proposed closure for the fertility unit. I might have quite a bit of sway, as some people think, but even I can't control when the trust decided that they're going to shut something. So I think that was a fairly low blow.
Councillor Riddle, do you wish clarification?
Yeah, I guess it was clarification from Councillor Belcherry when you said that you reduced the limit to 3 agreed by Chief Executive and the Mayor. What they actually agree upon the specific motions or what do you mean?
No, just purely the number.
Okay, can we have a short?
Okay.
point, the determination of all the threshold you agree should be down to the chief executive officer, primarily on my advice, and I believe you're the one by one officer, but should actually be done actually in consultation with the mayor.
Okay. Can I have a show of hands, all those in favour, please? Thank you. All those against? Thank you. That is carried. We'll move on to the next one, please. Chair, 3.7, the move of support services to be able to speak for a maximum of 5 minutes, currently it's 10. Any other speech or not to see a period of 3 minutes without the consent of the chair or council, so on the mayor. Chair, that makes the Councillor Riddle.
Thank you, Chair. Talking about some of the points of Councillor Thompson earlier, I mean, 3 minutes. 3 minutes. As it is at the moment, you know, we're talking about debating some quite significant issues. In my sort of limited time in this council general reading, we've debated issues related to the hospital, the A&E, the combined authority, some really serious issues. And if there are members opposite me, and I know we don't always agree on different things, but if you can honestly say to yourself, honestly, that you're comfortable with your contribution to some really significant socio-economic issues that we're trying to deal with in this town, is that 3 minutes. 180 seconds. That's not what we elected to do. We need to contribute meaningfully, not just give a snapshot or a couple of lines of what we think. That's a ridiculous situation.
Councillor Thompson.
Chair, just looking, I mean, I hear everything Councillor Rose said there. I did hope that might have been changed. Because when we had the consultation exercise, there was rumours flying around about that. There was a desire by certain people to reduce that down to three minutes. And the group that I was part of almost scoffed at that, as we said, it's the same amount of time that it takes out of the same water level. And that just shows that if you think that, unless you want me to come in here and start singing and dancing my way through the things in the future, I'm proud to do so, but that will show how silly this council chamber has become. When elected members who have been elected by the representatives of this town, the people who pay our wages and pay the council's wages, we're only going to give them 3 minutes of our time. Absolute nonsense.
Yeah.
Councillor Moore.
Chair, I'd second what Councillor Thompson said, and I would put forward that we do not change this and we do not enter this.
Seconded.
It's been seconded, so we've got to put the second motion So all those in favour of Councillor Moore and seconded by Councillor Thompson, please show. All those against?
Sort of only the Liberal could do it. So obviously like to move that we do reduce the budget to 5.
The reason why it's never been used to three Salton chief solicitor is because apparently Councillor Ritter's already articulated the only people that have used it is the representatives from the Labour group. And they're the only people that carry 17 votes. Nobody else in this chamber can use that. Even if my new best friend, Councillor Mark Wells, was to sign a call of motion. Now, the reality is that that mechanism is supposed to be there so that the majority political group can be held to account. An element of scrutiny, the only element of scrutiny that we seem to be having anymore. And if the only people that can call that in are members of the decision making, or the majority decision making, we either take it out completely or reduce it down to 5. Because there is members opposite who sometimes have spoken to me and agree with what I said, but they can't say it because there's a whip system and they'll get into trouble and they'll end up holding all your voice. But just by the grace of God, Councillor Hall's decided he's going to remain on the Normie step tonight and voted with us once. Because there is a glimmer of somebody there that's not frightened to speak against the whip. And I would be delighted if the council would be sat next to me, the next council meeting.
We'll go to the vote, please. It's straightforward. The proposal is for 17. Can I have a show of hands, all those in favour, please?
Viability of the marina and complement the arrival and investment of National Museum of the Royal Navy Party. Detailed master plan of this is now underway, with a view to the submission of proposed plans to our Regeneration Policy Committee later this year. Previous reports to Regeneration Policy Committee confirmed the existing building would limit the development opportunities. Therefore, demolition of the site clearly indicates our intention to secure a significant redevelopment of this site. In the short term, demolition will help address low-level antisocial behaviour concerns that have arisen over recent months, as it has been the antisocial behaviour hotspot over the summer, as reported to the council by police, and this is a waste of police resources that should be avoided. As detailed in section 3, it is recommended that the demolition costs are funded from the uncommitted 15-16 managed underspend. Assuming council approves this proposal, that there is then a net uncommitted 15-16 managed underspend of 51,000, and proposals for using this amount will be developed as part of a 17-18 budget process. The proposal before us tonight is simply not just about the demolition, but very much articulates our ambition for the site and the long-term prosperity of Harvey Vale. The site is seen by the council as strategically important to the redevelopment of Harvey Vale's waterfront and to the town's future economic growth. Removing the existing building offers the opportunity to relaunch the waterfront as a visitor destination and change people's perception of the area. Jackson's Landing as a building is associated with failure, and Hartlepool is worth much more than that.
Please, thank you.
The site was purchased given its potential for redevelopment rather than for the existing building, which restricts future opportunities and does not have the same potential for the transformational change of the area. Indeed, developers have had more than a decade to come forward with proposals that would stimulate economic growth and present business case that is affordable, achievable and sustainable. The current building was purpose-built as a retail outlet. The scale, configuration and design of the building means that it compromises what is achievable on the site. The building dominates the site in terms of scale and massing, which restricts options for high-quality new development. Quality of design is key to transforming the image of the waterfront, how it goes to tourist destination and attracting additional investment. The demolition of the building allows a range of new options, including purpose-built building types and styles that are more appropriate for the provenance of the area. I therefore move the recommendations per 3.9 report. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Councillor Craig.
Yeah, I'd like to second that the recommendations and present the right to Stephen Jones today.
Thank you. Councillor Thompson.
Chair, I'm permitted to ask a question before I go into debate.
Yes.
Okay. To leave the council, I put it to you if you can just light on there.
Can we?
Excuse me,
Councillor Thompson, please, and stop there. Please. Peter,
would you mind,
please?
I'm quite happy to apologise for that green word.
Chair, that would be preferable. Certainly, actually, members are all bound by code of conduct. You may be aware of that, nevertheless. If the question could be rephrased, and I'd retract as well, please.
Okay, Christopher, I apologise for calling you a liar. What I meant to say was, I believe that you were disingenuous to what you just said there. Can we continue the question now? Okay. I think you were disingenuous when you said that the Jackson's Landing had become the antisocial hotbed of the town. When the police put the statement out, they talked about the people in the water. They weren't talking about Jackson's Landing per se. They were talking about the entire dock. The kids would have still jumped in the marina, whether that building had been there or not. So are you prepared to clarify that?
In terms of recorded crime, three crimes have recorded a Jackson's Landing and the criminal damage and burglary. There have also been 21 instances of antisocial behaviour, including youths cleaning, attempting to get access to the building, climbing on the roof, throwing light things into the water and attempting to cause criminal damage. And this information was supplied to me as chair of the Safer Harbour Partnership by the police.
Well, I'm not going to get into a debate between you two on the outside of the chamber. Will you please restrict to the point that we are discussing, please, if you don't mind.
In response to Councillor Aitken's response there, some of those incidents, I've just explained, children throwing light points into the docks, and not associated, not hand in hand, with Jackson's Landing.
Yeah.
Have a look at how many reports of antisocial behaviour have been recorded in the last couple of weeks to do with the Schooner building and other sites across the town. Those sort of empty buildings that he wishes to pull down, invariably you're going to have that type of thing. But there's a bigger argument to have here. I still put it to him that is twisting statistics, twisting the truth, and is somewhat disingenuous.
Councillor Riddle. Question and clarification to Councillor Fellowship, that's allowed, Chair. It was really just to see clarification on the time frame of those statistics that you quoted related to, please.
The only information that was supplied to me by the minister was all the summer months.
Thank you, Councillor Tennant.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First of all, I'd like to thank Councillor Thompson for bringing this issue to fore, this petition and the Lord of Public Interest in this issue. As far as I'm aware, you appear to have no buyer for the building. You have no buyer for the land. I say this because no documentation has come to my attention, nor anybody in this side of the room. And if you think that's an acceptable reason to spend £40,000 of taxpayers' money for a building you purchased for £1.5 million just 3 years ago, that may well be part of your master plan, but we're not actually seeing any evidence of this. And also, Councillor Stephen Aitken's Fellowship was on Look North a few weeks ago, mentioned that the purchase of Jackson's Landing was a sound investment. But you know, 3 years down the line, no investment, no interest, no buyer, we're not getting any documentation, no facts are coming forward on this issue. Why are we not being given the full facts? Why the sudden need for the demolition of this building? It just seems to have come out of nowhere.
Yeah.
At this point, I'd like to raise an issue that Councillor Thomas actually brought to order in governance, seeking better quality of life for those disabled people who need a quality ability to get back to town. The ability to travel is something we all take for granted. And we're told there's no money to help certain companies get the vehicles they need in order to help save people get about this town. But I would argue that to spend £40,000 on something like that, people of this town. If your planned demolition begins the day after a family festival, I'm pretty sure that's fairly good joke. Thank you.
Yeah.
I urge every elected member to stop this demolition. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As a reasonably successful property developer, I lived in my West Park house since 2007, some 3 years before I got elected on this wonderful allowance that we got. So that's how I managed to live, by the way. I would agree that to keep the building up on the face of it would seem the logical thing to do. You would look at it as a developer, and I know developers that have looked at it, and then you would try and find a way of altering the building, because that building would cost an absolute fortune to build it today. When the previous owners first put it on the market, it was on the market for some £9 million. They didn't have any interest. They reduced it, and I think the final asking price was over some £2 million. They still had no interest from anybody. This local authority at the time decided that because there was an interest-free loan available, to start negotiating with those owners. We successfully bought that building, as now been widely reported, for £1.5 million using an interest-free loan, which, as far as I'm aware, and I'm not on finance, but I'm chair of audit, we have not paid interest on to date. It has not cost this authority a single penny in interest to own that building. And what's more important, to have control of the site. And that's the key thing, Mr. Mayor. It's not about the building, it's about the site. The site itself has been widely advertised. It's been derelict for a decade. We've tried to market the building for 3 years, and we have not got a successful buyer. I do know that we have had informal offers for the building, which would give this authority at least £250,000, and I know in one case £500,000 profit for them just to take the building as it is. But then we would be left in a situation where we would have no control over that building, and therefore that could impact on the surrounding area of the marina. I know the marina very well. I built the McDonald's, Councillor Riddle, sold it for £1.25 million, if you're interested, and still haven't quite spent it all yet. But I do believe that now is the time that we just demolish this building. We have got a figure in front of us of £40,000, which I feel sure we obtained when steel prices were slightly better than they are now. So I think that we did achieve a good price for the demolition. I believe if we went out to the market now, it would cost us a lot more. Also, as a developer's point of view, and I can speak from experience, if I looked at that building now, I would be probably putting a PC sum, which is a provisional sum, of around about £200,000 for the demolition, because there's no guarantees they're going to be able to sell that steel. So it's for that reason, and to secure the future of the site, that we, the Conservative Group, will support this. And I don't think we should be short-sighted. £40,000 is a tremendous amount of money, Councillor Tennant. And as you know, I fully agree that we should be trying to find some new ways of providing disabled transport, which is why I've headed up the committee that's actually looked at that. I do thank you for stepping in on one side for me. But we could generate a lot more money for the borough by properly disposing of this building, and we can only do that by a concentrated effort and getting the right developers on board. And that isn't just to go and stick a lot of apartments on. We've got thousands of apartments still with planning permission that haven't been built down in the marina. We need something that's actually going to generate. And it's proven that you can do this. You only have to look at where Marks and Spencer's now are on the Anchor Retail Park. That is now a thriving retail park. We're going to get Frank and Benny's there shortly. I feel confident that the retail park across the road will also end up thriving, but it's going to need a generator, and I believe that the Jackson's Landing site will be that generator. So that is why we will back the £40,000 tonight. It's short-sighted to say no to it, just to keep a building there, just for the sake of it, and to try and get some political mileage.
Yeah, we're being encouraged to spend further taxpayers' money on limiting our options. Demolishing it limits the options. The only thing that can go on there is a rebuild. Okay, there's a vision, but there's no concrete plan. In fact, with this constant mantra of vision this and vision that, I'm surprised I've went slightly cross-eyed in recent months. But the truth is, we don't have a plan, and how can we? You see, we've only just engage the experts, the architects, the consultants, the people that the press release was all detailed about, GT3, I think they were called, on the 18th of August. There was a press release put out. But they were engaged after finance and policy made its decision, after regeneration made its decision. So let me just take you through a little timeline. On the 22nd of July, the regeneration meeting met, and I think it was a fairly eventful meeting. We they agreed, because I didn't, that they were going to knock it down, they were going to demolish it, and the reasons that were cited at the time were discussions with developers. And I remember saying at the time, well, those developers should put their money where their mouth is. On Monday morning, sorry, the next day, on the Saturday, there was an article in the press, in the Hartlepool Mail, who's a little bit of it's can't do anything about their photos, and it says, in the quote that was put in fact, we're in discussions, negotiations, with a national hotel developer. But the reality is, what was actually said at the time, is that we're in very, very early, embryonic discussions and negotiations with those developers. Nothing more at this minute than a brief conversation. No plan, no credible plan. On the 25th of July, we then had the policy, financial policy meeting, and the decision was taken to provide the funding for it. But this is where it gets slightly interesting. About 4 weeks later, the Leader of the Council put out a statement through the Hartlepool Mail that said, the Council has sought leading architectural experts, and it's their clear view that it can be best, the site can be best maximised if Jackson's Landing is demolished. We aim to come forward in November time with desired proposals. So actually, that's 5 weeks, 4 weeks after we'd made the decision, and we were only just engaging with these experts. I mentioned the press release that was put out a couple of days later, and it was a joint press release, and JT3 architects were involved in that. And there's a line in there, again, sorry, Christopher, it's from yourself. I'm confident that the exercise that we're now undertaking. So we never did any exercise at the beginning. We decided to knock it down based on hearsay. But that's the reality. Despite what the rhetoric is that we're only doing this with the best advice, the advisors were only appointed after the decisions have been taken. Yet I'm yet to be presented with any factual advice that knocking it down, and I have asked for it, that it's in the best interest of the development that all options are being explored. Maybe the actual truth is behind a Facebook post that Councillor Ayres Belcher, Christopher Ayres Belcher, put out on the 11th of August. We are demolishing it, and I too have plans. It will be demolished. That I can guarantee. This to me suggests nothing more than a personal ego project, which will happen from hell or high water, regardless of who's got to say who, what, where, and when. All of this is not forgetting Councillor Martin Wells' statement on the 18th of February, when he stood up in that very spot and he said that we were close to sealing a deal on Jackson's Landing. And I think at that point he looked at myself and Jonathan and said, and some people have that smug smile wiped off their face. But I'm waiting to see where the deal is really.
You wind up the Councillor
Johnson, please. Chair, before that too, can I just ask, you did allow, because I was looking at my watch, you didn't allow your discretion, you did allow Councillor Martin Wells 8.5 minutes to speak.
No.
You did, because I was watching my watch. That's democracy, Martin. The pace at which is all this happening gives me further cause for concern. We seem to have went from raise and deals about to happen in February to suddenly wishing to knock it down. And the reality is it wouldn't have actually intended, it wouldn't have made it to this council meeting tonight if the source of the money to knock it down hadn't been changed. That's the reality. Because I remember asking you at the meeting, is this going to go to full council? And the freshie said no, but then that had to change. There has been a Facebook petition served, a petition served to the Chief Executive along with comments tonight and to the Chief Solicitor. And there is an action group.
Excuse me, I don't need you to tell me what to do. Thank you very much.
Somebody needs to.
With respect, I only have two more.
Councillor Thompson, if you wish to continue, please do so, but be brief, please.
I've got two more paragraphs, I'll speed read them. So, my suspicion is shared with many people who have taken the time to sign the petition that's being presented tonight, and local many residents who visited the action group, it's on Facebook, there is something like 1,600 people, 1,400 comments, and 2,500 unique posts for the parlour. 7,500 people from hardly 98% of them, which are all put comments forward. So I formally move tonight that the proposed funding is not agreed, and the proposed amount of demolition of Jackson's land is stopped. Until we consulted with members of the public, listen to the vision, listen, really listen, and feed that into the work the GT3V Commission to do. It's already been said that they're due to report back to finance and policy in November. That plan could be then presented to council in December for approval. Then we'll have a plan which the town supports, our electorate supports, people put us here support. So therefore I ask all councillors to support this new approach. Save the council 50,000, and I especially call on those members sat opposite who signed my petition. Thank you.
Mine's actually a contribution to the bit. Paul said everything that we need to say in their report. Well, mine really is a point of clarification to Council Mark. Well, I think it's really important that we have a cordial relationship among our councillors, so I would like to draw a line and onto the sort of tip for tat exchanges that we've seen now, the tap there, our acres obviously going on that. But I do think that, you know, what I would advise you, is I was not talking about you specifically, I made the remarks earlier. But I also would advise you to exercise caution when posting the public loan finances to the town where you could do it through banks. Funding is not agreed and the demolition is stopped.
so that we can consult with members of the public, listen to their vision, really listen, and feed that into the work that GT3 have been commissioned to do.
Thank you. That's been seconded. Can I have a show of hands, please? All those in favour of that proposed by Councillor
Thompson?
All those against, please show.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the public. I am a member of the Regeneration Panel, by the way. I would think the opposition need to wake up and smell the coffee. Michael Clark for Jackson's Landing was involved during the transformation era for a revitalised docking there many years ago. It was a popular attraction that was enjoyed by many of the clubs itself, but that was in the past. The building is in poor condition and has been stripped back to the shell, so it would need a significant investment to convert it. Therefore, more beneficial to clean the building and plan the site appropriately. The site is pivoted to plans to create a landmark destination on the waterfront. Send it close to the recently launched National Museum of the Royal Navy. The goal is to create a visit destination that local people will be proud of. Will attract visitors from across the North East region and further afield. This is the key to the potential expansion of Hartlepool's visitor economy. The precise form of mixed-use development that will take place on the site will be by informed market demand. The final development is likely to involve a combination of hotel and restaurants. These could interlink with a mix of specialty retail outlets, including leisure use and possibly some residential.
Will we still get the Ferris wheel?
This would create sufficient critical mass on the site, and it is likely that there would be a need for a new anchor visit the centre attraction. This will complement the visitor experience provided by the National Museum of the Royal Navy. The council has recently appointed Newcastle-based GT3 architects to lead an exercise aimed to create a mixed-use development. GT3 has been tasked with identifying areas of the site for key building development. This includes environmental design and pedestrian connections to adjacent sites, including the newly launched National Museum of the Royal Navy. Having the site in council ownership and moving forward with the demolition is a key factor. This will ensure the quality of any future development can be controlled. More importantly, it will be a significant opportunity to demonstrate the regeneration of the waterfront vision can and will be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Hunter.
Thank you, Chair. I've listened to many points today, mate. The forum has been very, very interesting. And I, like Councillor Lindridge, sit on the Regeneration Committee. A lot of people in this room remember Jackson's Landing with great fondness. When it was first created, a specialised shopping hall it was. I remember walking down, looking in the windows, knowing I couldn't afford to buy anything. But it was a great shop. But time moves on. It moves on, and that building is out of its time. When I heard that it was going to be the subject on one of our meetings with Regeneration, I thought, when you go down, we have a site visit. Because like a lot of people, I looked at that building then. What I found was a dilapidated building covering a massive piece of ground. Now, we've heard people say, if a developer comes in, they won't be bothered, they're not going to demolish the building. But yes, they will. Because the chances are that the developer will come in and want a percentage of that land, not all of it. And no developer is going to come in and purchase 20% of the land, pay 100% of the demolition cost. That piece of land is vital to the future of this town in making it an aggressive and competitive tourist destination. On that site, we can have multiple buildings that will complement the National Museum of the Royal Navy. And let's make no bones about it, getting that museum in Hartlepool was a phenomenal achievement. So we have to support that, and we have to make that work. We could have multiple attractions on there, we can have a hotel on there, we can have commercial sites on there, we can have leisure facilities, we can sell smaller pieces of the land. That's why it's crucial that that building does go. And once we get to that point, we start to see how these visions that are openly criticised by some people actually start to come together, and how this town is really moving forward as a destination town. We link that to the development of Church Street. £5 million being pulled in from external funders on that. £1 million to Church Square. This can be a destination town for people to come to, to enjoy, to stay over, to spend, and to tell their friends. And when they come here for those tourist things, they will see something else as well. A fantastic town, as was demonstrated by the course video. This is a special place to be. And this council is committed to making sure it remains that way. There are also other factors we need to take into account. That's how it benefits the town, whose councillors we vote for the town and for the people. If those multiple sites come to fruition, it will create jobs. Probably in the region, 250 jobs in the construction side, maybe probably 120 jobs when the operational side kicks in. The hotel, who has expressed an interest, has actually said they would estimate they would have 70 full-time employees working there. That's money into the people's pocket in Hartlepool. It puts food on the table, and it's what we're about. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
With all due respect, Councillor, that's all speculation, is it not? Councillor Cuddy.
Thanks, Chair. I wasn't actually going to speak tonight because I thought we discussed everything regarding the site itself. However, over the last couple of weeks, I've attended a number of meetings, one with the museum itself, and today with the new owners of the Vision Retail Park, who have all said that we need to remove that building, that it's an eyesore, and they would support the redevelopment of that area. One of the things I will read out is a letter that I received from Rhea Priestman, who was the chair of the Economic Regeneration Tourism Forum, where all the sort of professional private sector and voluntary sector and public sector meet on a regular basis. And it says, "Dear Kevin, proposed demolition of Jackson's Landing. Further to the above, I can confirm that the forum debated the merits of retaining or demolishing the building at its meeting held on the 25th of July, 2016. The forum recognises that the site has great potential, particularly on the back of the creation of the National Museum of the Royal Navy Hartlepool. The site is viewed as the best development opportunity in the marina, and due to the size and location of the site, could provide a range of development options, including hotel, leisure, and events, development of outdoor and also the outdoor entertainment space. The ferry building, due to its configuration, including internal pillars, is difficult to convert to other uses and has perhaps become a sign of failure, as it has remained empty for at least 10 years. On that basis, the forum supports the demolition of the existing building, taking provision of open space, picnic areas, and opportunities for delivering events, exhibitions, etc. In the longer term, the forum supports the development of mixed use and a particular investment that will add to the agricultural attraction and complement existing developments, including the marina navigation point and the National Museum in Wales.
I would like to clarify something then.
There is no, I'm sorry.
No, no, it's not acceptable.
It is not acceptable. No such thing as a point of clarification. Point of order. There's no such thing as a point of clarification. And then you can't say it's a point of order because it isn't.
No, I'm sorry.
If you're going to do this, you all want to do things properly. Let's do it properly.
Okay, so I would ask your advice then, Chair. I would like to come back to something Councillor Hunter said, which related to something I said. I would just like to clarify what was meant. So it's basically a point of personal opinion. Would that be correct? Or how would I best go about
Would you like to answer that, please?
Chair, yeah, members are very inventive. We do have no point of clarification. If one member mentioned about the point of exclamation at one point, you have actually a point of order. That really actually is any kind of failing you detect basically in your procedure rules or a matter of law. And the member should identify that particular breach of the procedure rule or a matter of law. And the other latitude to members is a personal explanation, on which basically a member, what they said previously in the debate, may be misconstrued. So essentially, it's constrained to the point of order of explanation.
And it's the point of explanation
that I'd like to make.
It's your knowledge, Josh. No. Yeah, I will. The part of it we think was. Councillor Lundgren said that we should need to smell the coffee. Believe me, I've been awake since 4 o'clock this morning and I've had plenty of coffee.
Is that the point?
No, it isn't. Councillor Hunter made very, very good points. I'll hand it to him. You've given the best explanation as to what this council is wanting to do that I've certainly heard and that I'm sure many of the public have heard. I'll applaud you on that, Councillor, because it's very good. And I wish that those points had been made on The explanation I'd like to make is, I have absolutely no love affair with the building. I believe it or not, despite the hair loss, I'm actually too young to have gone in there. I remember being open, I didn't do it. Or maybe I just, as a kid, £7.75 from Tommy Roll was never enough to go and buy it in there. But the point is, I have no love affair with the building. My serious concern is us spending money that we don't really have and that we could potentially put to something more. What I would say is, if and maybe it's a motion that we could put forward, that we knock back the demolition and we go back to whether a committee or
I'll shout you down as long as you like, but at the end of the day, you asked for a point of clarification, you were showing me and the solicitor explained and you said it was, and then you've gone and pontificated. I'm sorry, but it's not acceptable. Please dismiss the building. No, that's not the point of clarification, Councillor Mowat. It is not quite sorry. Councillor Mowat, please be quiet. Right. Can we please return to the original agenda item? And can we have a vote, please? All those in favour,
people will speak very patiently.
No, I've already explained to those people that have already spoken, Councillor Thompson.
I haven't spoken on this motion, it's a separate motion. Chair, point of order then, through yourself to the Chief Solicitor. The first one time I spoke was a speaking on the first motion which I presented. I now wish to speak on the second motion. Is that an order?
Yes, it is.
So I can speak.
If it is on the second, on the original motion, not what you said. Right.
Well.
And as long as you stick to it, Councillor Thompson, that's fine. Please do not vary away from it.
You have my sincerest pinky promise that I will not.
I will take that with a pinch of salt.
Thank you. Councillor Hunter,
gave me cause for concern during some of the things. First of all, it was the most allegation I've seen in the Labour group for some time. But he did give me some cause for concern. He spoke about that building being dilapidated and needs to come down as soon as possible. To my recollection, there's 5,000 people going in that building this weekend. And that worries me now that as a local authority we're about to put 5,000 people at risk. I'm being flippant because I don't believe it is dilapidated at the stage where it needs to come down immediately. And that's the point I want to make. Councillor Cranny started to read letters from home. I'd like to do some myself. As part of the consultation exam, the petition that I did, I had a number of, about 800 comments. One of them said, I'm fed up with our council wasting our money. They're supposed to do what's best for the town, not for themselves. Second comment, there's no need to demolish a building without a plan in place. Leave it up there with all the options open. I could go on. I could go on 800 times. The reality is, as Councillor Hunter said, surprisingly, we're there to represent the views of people that elected us and vote for the best of the town. Not ignore what people are saying. I did a very quick consultation in 6 weeks. 800 comments, and the vast majority say, keep it up in its masses. I just want to say one very quick thing to end up. This shows you the true value of democracy in this council chamber. I mean, people have seen it tonight, and it absolutely bores me. Councillor Hunter seems to know a lot about the hotel deal. The hotel deal that we were told very publicly, not that long ago, was very embryonic. We're in negotiations, early negotiations. Yet, all of a sudden, there's a promise of 70 jobs. That, to me, when a developer says, I will bring 70 jobs to your town, that is an embryonic. That's a deal that's done. And there is an element of mushroom syndrome in this council chamber, where certain councillors are kept in the dark and fed you know what.
I've been in the same situation. I don't want to get the same way. Well, we get into an argument across the floor, and I'm going to move the board. I'm sorry, I'm going to move the board. Can I please have a show of hands, please, all of those in favour of the original motion, which is to demolish Jackson's Landing?
Judas.
I've just given you some offer. Jamie Price, I'll buy it. You have no idea who I am. I have £700 million in the bank. I would buy that building. I can guarantee it wouldn't be a job. There's your bet.
I'm an investor.
Let the man stand up.
Come on, stand up, son.
Come on,
get up. All those gifts, please.
There's your bet. I'm off it. You must ignore this.
Any abstentions?
No, I'm sorry, I was voting against.
Thank you. That motion is passed. Thank you for that. We now move on to item 12. Consider the motions and the order in which votes have been received. Item A. Thank you.
Chair. It's just with regards to the last comment about being part of the modern officers. The constitution is, and I would be happy for it to be considered by the work group of council. The fact that the opposition members of the
council are
setting up.
Excuse me, please.
You must have to speak into the microphone.
Okay.
Thank you. That's all I want. Thank you.
Did members hear what was said?
No.
No. Would you repeat, please, Councillor?
Councillor, given that the decision that the Chair of Audit and Governance was based on SIPCA guidance, I'm happy if Councillor Tennant is agreeable for that to be considered as back the Constitution Working Group of Council. Councillor Tennant?
Well, as I understand, the members' group, it works alongside the Chief Monitoring Officer in the Constitutional Review, as I requested. I'm happy to pass it forward.
Okay, thank you. Can we all agree on that then? Yes? Okay, thank you for that. Can we move on to the next one, please, being Councillor Tennant?
We move that Hartlepool Council elected members recognise the results of the EU referendum on June 23rd, 2016 and call upon Her Majesty's Government to invoke Article 50 at the earliest opportunity. In order to know where we stand financially in the years after Brexit becomes a reality, it is important for this borough to seek central government funding from the savings made by no longer having to contribute to EU funding.
Thank you. We have a second there, please.
No second.
Councillor Hyde, if you wish to speak.
No, second.
Thank you. Councillor Christopher, Spell Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm happy with the content of the motion and I would like to add to it through an amendment to say at the end of it that we also call upon the government to commit to the £350 million per week investment into the NHS outlined in the pledges of the League campaign, and we request commitment that the European funding is replaced with regional funding based on needs, having regard to the levels of deprivation in towns like Hartlepool. Councillor Riddle.
Irrespective of the amendment, that I'm kind of frustrated by the original motion, and not because you could put one forward. In some respect, I'm grateful that they have, having some of their members of Sandy's Council to so, I do think this motion seriously misunderstands what Hartlepool councillors are elected to do. And we live in a town, as I mentioned, with serious challenges. I'm not going to name them all, but there's unemployment, education underachievement, health issues, to name them three. And as 33 councillors, we're at the sharp end of that working with our offices to try and address those challenges. We're local councillors. We don't work in central government, we said don't work in the European Parliament. And when people ring me, they ask, why is my name being empty? Or are you getting anywhere with free parking issue? No one in Hartlepool has ever contacted me as a councillor asking me to speak of Britain's Brexit from the European Union. And right now, I can tell you this, because if you read about this, you will find out that our government is already working very, very hard to organise Brexit. And I am no fan of the Conservative Party, but I do know that they have a team of 393,000 civil servants trying to execute Brexit. And they are trying to unpick 12,295 EU regulations and over 50 separate trade deals. So, it's a very complicated process. It can't be rushed. Certainly can't be done 3 months after a referendum. Already Whitehall has advertised for 300 negotiators, trade specialists to strengthen their team. PricewaterhouseCoopers and the ones that calculated, we're talking about just in the financial sector in this country alone, a potential £12 billion situation. Brexit negotiations need to be slow, cautious, careful and well organised. And members, without being into some clipping, what actually we expecting to happen here? Us as Hartlepool councillors send a letter to Theresa May, she reads it, or or Barclay, they really think we should speed up, we should move quicker. Does she get any more time for Merkel? Could do that? It's a waste of time. So with respect, as much as I do welcome the participation from you in the council, my suggestion would be you withdraw this motion because it's a waste of everyone's time.
I think I'm feeling quite light-headed, Mr. Mayor, because I found myself agreeing with councillors for the first time tonight. I must admit, when I see this motion, I suddenly guidance and went to the House of Commons. But quite simply, I don't believe it's our place. I think I mentioned this at the very first time that, that there was something mentioned by the two UKIP councillors at the time, which this they proposed that we, as an authority, should support Brexit. I think I explained at the time, I didn't really understand it then, and even after the vote, I'm still struggling to try and come to terms with what it was all about. all I would say is the next time I get an invite down to Downing Street, I'll never mention it to the Prime Minister, because I think it'll have more effect than us sending the letter. Councillor Spring.
70%, thank you, Chair. 70%, I think that's the last figure, it's half 68, I wouldn't say to your direction, 68 point something, of the people of Hartlepool said they wanted Brexit. And I keep getting people asking me, what are you doing about it? And I know there's not a lot that we can do other than urge, and this is what I think this motion is all about, urge the local council to just say to the government, the people of Hartlepool, not only of Hartlepool, but of the North East, want to get this thing over and done with quickly. And we get the impression that they're dragging their feet. Now, I know there's negotiations, we understand that. There's got to be a bit of unravelling. But at the end of the day, the people of Hartlepool, and this keeps on coming up, this is what the people want about our, not what we want, but what they want. We may agree with them, but that's what they want. And I keep on hearing this over and over again. I just say that I think it's a sensible motion. It's not triple trifle. It's necessary just to pass the message on to those who are in authority of us that we want this thing dealt with very quickly. Please don't drag your feet. We understand the stuff, but we want it to be on. That's what the people are looking for.
Thank you. There has been an amendment to the original motion.
I'd like to make an amendment to the amendment. It's possible to accept this amendment without the statement of the £350 million NHS.
I must be one side in my head as well, because I think I agree with Chris Greg Belcher that if we're going to put this motion forward tonight, it has to go with the caveats that have been put forward. It's a simple answer. What I am at the loss at is how this motion's actually ended up on the table tonight.
Yeah,
because the nights of the thousand dancers when we tried to have a debate on Brexit, Europe and that, and it was prevented. Yet we seem to be doing very the same now. I'm not too sure why. I don't really want an explanation. I'm just puzzled with the thing here. But we are where we are, as they all say.
I'm sorry, but if you go on and throw up with an explanation.
I'd be delighted, and I'm sure the people in the gallery would as
well. Chair, the reason actually why the motion previously was not allowed, which obviously we asked for support for basically Brexit, was because it would defend against the court of publicity. Because obviously we were then actually in the realms actually dealing with the referendum. We now have the pause of the referendum.
Thank you. Right. You're not accepting the amendment. So, we've got to have a vote on the amendment. Although
based on need, having regard to the levels of deprivation in towns like Hartlepool.
So we all know what it is, right? Can I have a show of hands, please? All those in favour of the amendment?
Such an additional appointment would actually be consistent with the and reflect the overall composition of the council through its political groups and not out of line with the original composition, which was 16 members of the committee under council's governance arrangements when adopting a committee-based system of governance.
Do we have a seconder, please?
Yes.
Which one is going to second this? Councillor Bowman seconds it, thank you. Am I right there, yes, I'm Councillor Bowman seconds it. Yes, thank you, because we need the records to figure out. Right, any comments?
No?
No comments? Right, the board? Can we have a vote, please? All those in favour of the motion by Councillor Tennant, please show. Thank you. All those against? That motion is lost. Thank you for that, colleagues. Can we now move on, please, to item 13? That is to receive the Chief Executive's report. Pass any such resolution thereon as may be deemed necessary.
Thank you very much. The first item in my report relates to expenditure relevant to members' interests, and that's there for members to note. Moving on to this.
Chair, obviously there's a number of, we've already highlighted, there's a number of inaccuracies in that report. In this spirit of transparency, correct version we put out in a few minutes.
Yes, I'll do that. Make arrangements for that, Councillor Thompson, and also look into the systems by which this is put in place. Yes. Second item relates to appointments to committees, and I've had notification from the UKIP group that they'd like to replace Councillor Hind with Councillor Bookham on the Finance and Policy Committee. And a notification from the Labour group that they would like to replace Councillor Stephen Akers Belcher with Councillor Christopher Akers Belcher on the Civic Honours Committee.
Councillor Christopher Belcher. Does I also have an addition that the Labour group wishes to change the composition of Children's Services and replace Councillor Hall with Councillor James?
have a show of hands, please, all those in favour.
Pass on, especially my thanks and
thank you.
Councillor Barnes.
Yeah, thank you, Jack. I just want to echo what's already been said to Councillor Peter Jackson. He's probably one of the most assiduous of the student members, or he was one of the most assiduous members of this council. He served at the number one well, but also the Old Crossing Club for 14 years, I think he was. And I really hope that in the future.
Can I ask members of the public, please, not to be stung while councillors speaking, please? Thank you.
And I really hope that in the future they just consider going back into politics.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? Councillor Thompson?
I think everything's been said, and Alan just said it very eloquently about the various communities that Peter served. But despite all of the fact that he was a councillor, despite the fact that he had some of the traits that we all have, he was a bloody nice guy, and he still is a really nice guy. He's an honest, genuine gentleman who, you know, I won't blame him for not wanting to be part of some of the stuff that comes with this council. And I wish him a very long, very happy retirement from your politics.
Councillor Wells.
Thank you, Chair. Worked alongside Pete for 6 years, spoke to Pete at length about his imminent departure. I think one thing I would say is that I admire the man. He could have quite easily have just turned up to his one meeting every 6 months, claimed his allowances and called it a day. But he's more honourable than that. He realised that his work commitments was the thing that made that he couldn't continue being a councillor. He couldn't give his residents and constituents all of his attention, and that's why he's resigned. And I think on behalf of the Conservative Group, we acknowledge the hard work he's done as a councillor, but also as a portfolio holder, and indeed he was more than fair when he was dealing with other elected members in a position as portfolio holder when their decision was almost final. He was always there to listen to the other side, and on behalf of the Conservative Group, we thank him for that.
Thank you, Councillor Hunter.
Thank you, Chair. I'd just like to provide a comment that Councillor Thompson just made. Councillor Jackson did not decide to retire because of anything to do with this side of the chamber. Councillor Jackson went because of his work commitments, which were excessive, and also because his daughters and his grandchildren spent a lot of time down the south. And I can say that because I actually know Councillor Jackson than anybody in this room. Because I'm known as this one year old. And I know the reasons he's gone, and it's nothing to do with the other side of the room.
I'm going to say it. He's a very knowledgeable councillor, and like David just said, he will be coming back. Right? And perhaps when he is back, some of them councillors, like the one just been on, will not be here themselves.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councillor Peter Jackson, hard-working, loyal, a loyal member of this Labour group, will be sadly missed. When I was first elected in 2012, I raised you to the Heart Ward. Councillor Jackson gave me a lot of pointers, especially around neighbourhood services. The sterling work that he did on neighbourhood services should be commended by this council. Peter will be sorely missed, and although me and Mary sent him and his family our best wishes, I hope that he will find the time to come along, support what we're doing, and eventually become a
thank you. Anybody else wishing to comment? I'd just like to say I've known Peter for many years. He was an excellent professional footballer. He was a damn good footballer. I refereed him on a number of occasions, and he had some very good skills as a footballer, which he brought to being a councillor. He was very professional in the way that he approached things. He was straight as a die, and as far as I'm concerned, I wish him all the best for the future.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And moving on, finally, there have been no more special agency decisions taken during the period of February to July, and that concludes my report.
Thank you very much indeed for that. We'll now move on to item 14, to receive questions from and provide answers to the public in relation to matters of which notice has been given under Rule 11, before we ask the agreed help council to pursue this object.
I'm sorry, Mr. Mayor, it's just that with the item that's being asked on the public question, I will need to declare a prejudicial interest. As most members are aware, I'm a health watch manager at Hartley Hill and been working collaboratively with the Governance Committee on Securing Practices to remain in Hartley Hill. So I need to declare that interest, so I'll not be able to be present while the question is being asked.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Thomas. Thank you. Councillor Tempest. Thank you. Councillor Stephen Avery-Belcher. Councillor Belcher. Thank you very much indeed. Are you ready? Sorry, Councillor
Chairman. Before we actually debate this motion, can I actually clarify the motion of actually an error in it? And it's only while we sat here reading it that I'm not quite sure it actually says what it intended. At the very end of the first sentence, it says that Hartlepool are one of the lowest patient to GP ratios. And I actually think that that's not accurate.
What I'm trying to be
said
is that we have a lot of patients who are very few GPs, but that's not what actually the motion says. So if it needs to be amended, I would prefer it to be amended. Is that what you mean? Yeah. Can we have that amended accordingly, please, Peter?
Thank you, Councillor Jones. And with the approval of the questioner, I'll reverse the ratio. So the question is from Mrs. Carroll, and it's to the Chair of Audit and Governance Committee. And the question reads as follows. It is widely acknowledged that there is a crisis in primary care in the UK, and that Hartlepool has one of the lowest GP to patient ratios in the country. What is Hartlepool Borough Council constructively and proactively doing to prevent the closure of any of the three EPMS practices currently under review in the town? Please can you advise me on the process from now on?
Councillor Raymond Well, Chair of Audit and Governance.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As the body responsible for the Council's statutory health scrutiny functions, the Audit and Governance Committee has and continues to be involved in the APMS contract review process. In 2014, we were advised that the three APMS contracts in Hartlepool were to expire at the end of March 2015, and that a 10-week consultation was to be undertaken. In the period between then and now, the committee, its chair, vice chair, and ward councillors for the affected areas have worked alongside the CCG and NHS England to ensure that they take into consideration residents' issues and concerns in relation to the review process and the future of the practices. In doing this, we have taken every opportunity to inform and have influenced subsequent decisions, and these are as follows. Initially, to have the contracts initially extended, all back, all three of them, until the 31st of March 2016, to further extend Fens and Winded Road contracts until the 30th of September 2016 to allow additional engagement to inform the procurement exercise and to secure a new provider from the 1st of October 2016. Further, to procure a provider for the Hartfield service with effect from the 1st of April 2016, although this proved to be unsuccessful. We are now in a position where we are all, residents and councillors alike, being asked to participate in a consultation process and fight for the future of these practices. As a council, we will continue to promote consultation events across the town have facilitated with NHS England the provision of an additional event at the Fens Primary School on the 22nd of September at 5 p.m, and this was in response to public demand. In addition to this, the Audit and Governance Committee has requested the CCG and NHS England at its attendance meeting on the 22nd of September 2016 at 10 a.m. to enable the formulation of a formal council response to the consultation. This will be submitted to the CCG's primary care core commissioning committee to inform them as to the decision on how to continue services in Fens, Parkfield and Wingham Road. In turn, this decision will be formally reported back to Audit and Governance Committee, at which point a view can be taken as to whether any further action is required within our statutory scrutiny powers, which could include a referral to the Secretary of State. I strongly encourage everybody to get involved in this consultation process. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. What else? Any comments? Yeah. Sorry, Councillor Riddle.
Yeah, is it permissible to ask a quick question and then go to the debate? Can I see clarification that as a council we have made it crystal clear to the CCG that our wish is to retain the services of all three?
Yes, it is, Councillor Riddle. We've had several informal meetings with the CCG and with NHS England, and I think they are fully aware of the Council's position.
Okay. Just in addition to that, thank you for that. It's worth remembering, isn't it, that when the situation with hospital care and we've been given assurances in terms of the Momentum project that the mitigation for the budget of the hospital would be offset to some extent by a comprehensive range of community-based services. You know, we would have sufficient number of doctors' facilities and such like things of that nature. This does look like, obviously, a few steps down the path that seems to be going not in the direction we want that to be, but these services, these three, or at least two possibly, are still under threat. So just for absolute clarification, I hope for the first time we'll be able to make a unanimous vote for the motion. For the purposes of pure clarification for the CCG, can this council write a letter to state categorically in black and white that our desire, even before the results of the consultation, our wish of the council is for the retention of all three services? Can I put forward that as a motion from you two?
Can you inform the time, please?
Chair, it's really, as mentioned, actually, consideration for the Audit and Governance Committee and whether they exercise their statutory powers of referral. So it's not really the opportunity that the council is able to inform us of predetermined matters.
Are you suggesting that it goes to Audit and Governance for them to
do more? What I'm suggesting is I assume, I hope rightly, that we have 33 members that all agree on the same thing, 10 to 3 practices. Therefore, all I'm asking, we've obviously strongly intimated to them that is our wish, that we put that in writing and give them absolute clarification that that is what we want. So that is what the people of Latvia want.
We don't legally clean those, I don't know.
Okay. Chair, it really has to go through a process, and it's been adequately mapped out as regards the route that this will take, the good audit governance as regards whether they exercise their powers of secretary referral. So that predetermination of pre-judicial matters, it really has to be based on chief people to audit in this committee.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Clark.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I want to comment on this with regards to the actual consultation itself. I've attended two consultation events, and both of them are at best what I would call farce. I attended one at Rosmere last Saturday, and I also attended one at Carfield and went to the, and there are a number of issues there. What we really need to do is, I don't want to say anything right now, if it's going to jeopardise the outcome of the Audit and Governance Committee's, their response to the consultation.
Thank you, Chair. I think at this stage, going back to what the Councilman asked me, and I didn't give the answer, in the early stages, we made our position very clear that it was our wish that all three, they have then said that they will go through the consultation exercise, which they are now in the process of doing. I think we really need them to come back with their proposals, and then we fully debate those proposals at Audit and Governance, and I would be delighted if every elected member would come along to that.
the date and time is already set. Otherwise, I would have considered altering it so Councillor Morrison could actually definitely attend that. But I don't think that we can change that now. It's for all in governance to make that recommendation to full council at that point in the future. But you know, I guarantee that members' wishes will be there. I'm quite happy for elected members, if they can't make that meeting, to either email me or put their views across to me by Joan. However they want to contact me, and I make sure that their wishes are taken into account, even though they might not be a member of Audit and Governance. We are a part of this local authority. We will listen and we will take those opinions into account. Likewise, as I've always done, and any members of the public who have attended one of my Audit and Governance committees, I do bring members of the public into the debate. I never exclude anybody, and I'll actually reserve this chamber for the next meeting in order that more members of the public can come along. So I think at this point, Chair, to try and preempt it and predetermine it might not be helpful long term, because I've been sure that the CCG would rightfully say that we have predetermined before we actually see what they're recommending.
Chair, we have, with our constitution, statutory scrutiny procedure rules, and it is the case actually whereby, following an investigation, the committee basically believes there should be a referral to the state, that might actually be necessarily reported through to council. What I'm saying is at this stage, as mentioned, basically, there's been some element of consultation, the matter still has received basically through the committee for their due inquiry. Until you reach that stage, you should not actually predetermine matters, which actually could be to the detriment of the work of the committee. So I say you need a formal process to be outlined by the chair of the governance committee. There'll be an open invitation to members of the public, hence the basis of booking this council chamber, to facilitate that. I think, Mr. Mayor, that would also be worthwhile. That general invitation to be expressed by Councillor Martin Wells this evening was put in the right of all members to attend that committee meeting. At least be able to make representations there. You need all of the formal process.
Thank you. Yes, Councillor Rill.
Yeah, just for clarification, I don't think I've asked anything that you can't have already apparently put in there. I just want to just try and push this just a little bit for me. All I'm really asking is that you agree to explain to them our preference, if we had to completely try to, whatever we could choose, our preference as a town, as council. All that seems to be clarified. I'm not talking about consultation, I'm not talking about pre-determined decision, I'm just trying to articulate them in print, so we're all agreed on that, but what we prefer is public attention to that.
Well, I do sympathise what you're saying, also real. We've got to notice of what the solicitor has said, and we must follow that procedure. So we will actually do what has been suggested by the chair of Audit and Government, and that the invitation will be open to all members of the public also, to come along to the meeting, which I think is next day, where everybody will be allowed to say what they like, and also if, as you rightly said, that you will not be able to attend, if you wish to contact or speak to Councillor Rhodes,
you do exactly what
Can we ask the other councillors to come back in, please? Minutes of the meeting held by the Clayton Fire Authority held on the 10th